Mandrin is a rendering engine built in Houdini, so you get it out of the box. This may be one of the reasons why I've been getting requests to do a mantra tutorial, probably because everyone using Houdini has mantra. Many of you know that I mainly use Redshift because of its rendering speed. Mantra is a CPU-based rendering engine, so you need a pretty good computer to render anything within a reasonable time frame. Although Mantra isn't known for its speed, it's actually a very decent rendering engine that can produce high quality images. It just takes a lot of cores and a lot of time. Now, if you're trying to produce an in-house short animation, Mantra may not be the best option, but who knows? If you're a student living in a dorm and electricity is paid as a flat fee, you can probably just leave the computer on day and night, given that you have quiet CPU fans and you can sleep through that while the thing's on. But I have heard of professional studios with in-house rendering farms that use Mantra to produce high-quality projects. I'm guessing the licensing is way more budget-friendly compared to other rendering engines. I'm going to go over some of the parameters in Mantra's rendering node. I'll be focusing on the sampling tab and the limits tab. I'll be sticking with ray tracing as the selected rendering engine in Mantra. I split this into two videos because Mantra has so many parameters to go over. In this video, we'll cover the basic concepts in Mantra needed to know for the sampling tab. I'll also get into detail with a couple of useful parameters and how their values change the render quality. The rest will be saved for the next video. That the rendering engine is trying to reverse engineer the light path from the camera's point of view because we want to optimize what we need to calculate. If the camera doesn't see it, there's no point in unnecessary light path calculations. So let's start off with the pixel samples. The pixel samples controls practically all other sampling values. I like to think of it like a global multiplier for all the other parameters on this tab. If you increase the pixel sample, it increases everything else. For example, the diffuse quality parameter. By increasing the pixel sample, it'll increase the diffuse quality as well, and thus increasing the overall quality of the image. And this is done automatically for all other parameters. So you need to be careful when you're increasing the pixel sample values because it'll make the rendering times a lot longer since you're telling Mantra to compute more for everything. Let's move on to the min-max samples. The min-max samples act as a range for each of the parameters below here on this tab. By increasing this range, it will affect the behavior of each parameter and also increase the quality of the render overall. And in order to explain how these parameters work, I need to go over some basic concepts. So you start off with the camera shooting rays onto the scene, which is known as primary rays in Mantra. The pixel samples determines the number of primary rays that shoot out per pixel. Pixel sample parameter has two values, X and Y, which are usually set to the same value, but in rare cases can be different. I honestly always have left it as the same value for both X and Y pixel samples. The higher the pixel sample, the better the quality of the render. However, the higher the pixel sample, the longer it takes to render. And this is set on a global scale, as I've mentioned. So back to the primary ray that gets shot out from the camera onto the objects in the scene. This camera ray bounces on objects in the Houdini scene and bounces off in all directions. And these bounce rays are known as secondary rays in Mantra. Because these rays bounce in all directions, there are actually two types of secondary rays, direct rays and indirect rays. Direct rays are the rays that are bounced off the object and has a direct line to the light source. So why is this useful? Mantra uses this technique to figure out what objects are hiding behind other objects. So it knows where to create the shadows. So say there's a light source here and an object here. And finally, the second object here. By using this direct ray, Mantra will know where the shadow is placed. So this is where the min-max ray samples comes in. The min-max ray samples controls how many secondary rays are calculated. Obviously, the more secondary rays, the better the quality of the render, and at the cost of longer computing times. Basically, in more simplistic terms, it's the number of light rays that you can adjust to tweak the quality of the soft light in your renders. Moving on to the noise level. This is the level of noise that you're willing to tolerate in your scene. The higher this value, the lower the quality you'll get in the renders. And the same vice versa. The lower the value, the higher the quality. Simply because when this value has a very small value, it means a lower noise value is tolerated in your scene. Mantra will keep computing until it achieves this noise level. So you start off with a really noisy render for your first set of light rays that gets computed. Then Mantra repeats the process, shooting a second set of rays, and the image quality improves, becoming less noisy. Now this process is repeated several times until Mantra achieves the noise level you specified here. If you specified a really large noise value, then Mantra has less work to do. If you specified a really small noise level, Mantra has to work harder and repeat the process more and more, shooting out more and more light rays to compute. Every time Mantra shoots out more rays, the image gets less noisy. Now, Mantra doesn't just compute forever in order to achieve this noise level. So say you picked a noise level of 0. Mantra's only gonna compute within the range you picked for the min and max ray samples. So for example here, the maximum ray samples is 9, which will be used to get to a noise level of 0.01. So after 9 ray samples are used, so after Mantra shoots out 9 secondary rays, Mantra will give up even if it hasn't achieved the 0.01 noise level. But if Mantra manages to get the noise level down to 0.01 with, say, less than 9 rays, like 4 rays or something, it'll stop computing because 0.01 noise level is achieved. So the noise level is more of a goal that Mantra will use for reference. So the global quality. I'm actually not sure what's the difference between this global quality parameter and the pixel samples, but when increasing the global quality parameter, it'll increase the quality of your renders. It's like a global multiplier for all the other parameters to improve the render quality overall. Okay, now on to the diffuse quality parameter. The diffuse quality only affects the indirect light rays, so the secondary rays for the light, and this parameter acts as a multiplier for the min and max ray samples. So that's that range that I talked about just at the beginning. But this only applies to the diffuse lighting of the indirect light rays. If you set the diffuse quality to 2 and the min and max ray to 1 to 3, let's say, then the actual ray sampling will be 2 to 6. So if this was 1 to 3 and our diffuse quality was 2, we would be getting ray sampling would be like 2 to 6, because it's doubles, because the diffuse quality is set to 2. Everything is multiplied by 2. Diffuse light is the main light source that is evenly distributed on an object's surface. And for this diffuse quality parameter, it refers to the indirect light rays, or the secondary light rays in Mantra, that is contributing to the diffuse light source onto the object. So this only affects the secondary rays, and it's controlled by the min and max ray sampling range. Now, in order to get the indirect diffuse lighting to work in your scene, you need to turn up the diffuse limits in the limits tab, which is located right next to the samplings tab right here. I'm going to go over the limits tab with more details a little later, but I really wanted to show you how to render with indirect diffuse lighting, and I wanted to show you how the indirect diffuse light is contributing to the scene. Mantra has a feature where you can render out each lighting component individually, which is super handy for debugging the lights in the scene. It's also widely used for post-processing in the VFX industry pipeline. So if you come over here, so we've been dealing with the rendering tab over here. Right next to it is the images tab. If we come over here, extra image planes down here. You can choose which lighting components to be exposed and render it out along with the image. Perfect for debugging the lights in the scene. You can have a better picture of how each lighting component is affecting the scene. Turn this on, indirect lighting. This will render out the indirect diffuse lighting component of the scene. So that's this one right here. And for the limits, the diffuse limit. So this is zero right now. So the diffuse is not really affecting the scene right now. So I just want to show you what it looks like before we have it turned on. Okay, I'm going to take a snapshot. Now let's go to the limits. Let's give this 10. So you can start to see a difference. This is a lot smoother. That's what diffuse lighting will do. It's the indirect rays. So it's the secondary rays contributing more to the scene, which will give you a lot more soft light, and everything will look a lot more softer, more fluffier, more... if you're looking for a sweet and gentle scene, turning this up will definitely help you. Okay, let's come over here. And because we rendered out the indirect lighting components, we have more choices down here. So C is our regular color scene. It's whatever the final image looks like. And everything else are the light components. These are the indirect light components, which are activated by this selection. Now we're interested in the indirect diffuse. So this is only the indirect diffuse lighting. So let's take a look what the indirect diffuse lighting looked before. So let's go back here. Nothing. Because if we go here, the limits, because this diffuse limit was set to zero. So the limit was zero. So no diffuse lighting was, there was like no diffuse lighting. That's why the previous scene that was rendered is for the indirect diffuse, we see all black because there was nothing. There was like no diffuse. For this one, we can see all the diffuse lighting here. And let's come back here. So this is the final image. With all the lighting of this, all these lighting components all combined together. This is what you get. This is what it looked before. So this is not as bright, it's not as soft, it's a little dull. This is more, it looks soft. So that's what diffuse lighting can do to your scene. The reason I used the rubber toys to demo the effects of each parameter in this video is because the dorm room scene at the beginning of the video takes a while to render out, and there's a lot of complex lighting going on in there. The rubber toys are simple scene setups that can allow you to focus the attention to understanding each parameter. Then you should move on to more complicated scenes like the dorm room that contains a lot of objects in place to practice rendering with different lighting conditions. This video took forever to finish, all the way from research, recording, to editing, because Mantra has a lot of parameters. So the rest of the parameters will be discussed in upcoming videos, which are in the works currently in the editing process. But I must say, Mantra is a very interesting rendering engine. I feel like there's so much more to be explored, like custom PBR materials or VEX-driven PBR materials. Custom PBRs will be more beneficial as a learning experience, in my opinion, to obtain a deeper understanding of how shaders, materials, and rendering engines actually work behind the scenes. Practicality-wise, for custom PBRs, you probably can just buy that somewhere online for a couple hundred bucks or so. Maybe not worth the time to build a PBR material library from scratch just to render things in Mantra. But the knowledge is priceless and could push your creativity to a new level. For example, if you need to create a new material that doesn't exist in life or for a big project, custom PBRs may come in handy. So this is definitely a topic worth exploring, in my opinion. Thank you for watching and sticking to the end.